Billy Baer, and hosting me is Dan Haggerty. Our guest today is Dr. Jerome Corsi. Dr. Corsi received a PhD in political science in 1972 from Harvard University and is currently an investigative reporter for WorldNet Daily. In 2004, he co-authored the number one New York Times bestseller, Unfit for Command, Swift Boat Veterans Speak Out Against John Kerry. Since 2004, Dr. Corsi has written five New York Times bestsellers, including The Abomination, Leftist Politics, and The Cult of Personality. Jerry Corsi is a frequent guest on nationally broadcast radio talk shows and has made numerous television appearances on Fox, MSNBC, and CNN. Our discussion this week will focus on Dr. Corsi's most recent book, Where's the Birth Certificate? The Case That Barack Obama Is Not Eligible to Be President. Welcome, Dr. Corsi.
Good to be with you, gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Dan, you there?
Yes, I'm here. So how are you, Dr. Corsi?
I'm doing great. Thank you very much, Dan. Good to be with you.
Yes, very interesting book. What I want to do is go right to a couple of short paragraphs out of the book that kind of sum up your thesis for me. I find them very interesting, and I want to read them out. From your book, it's on page 117. Now that we know Barack Obama has presented false information about his early life, we must reasonably ask if the entire official nativity story is likewise a fabrication. And you go on a different page. Having discovered a lie at the heart of a story, the American public has a right to the full truth of Obama's birth, including the right to see all relevant documentary evidence that he meets the Constitution's natural-born citizen requirement. This is a matter of law. If President Obama's official story turns out to have been fabricated to hide a truth that would make him ineligible, the American people will demand the situation be rectified, even if it requires impeachment. No usurper of the office of the President of the United States can be tolerated if the Constitution is to have enduring authority. Dr. Corsi, would you say that's a good statement of the thesis of your book?
That's exactly right. I mean, the point is that when we look at Barack Obama's qualifications to be president, under Article 2, Section 1 of the Constitution, natural-born citizen, he's not eligible. That's my subtitle. He's not eligible for several reasons. I think the evidence is increasingly clear that he was born in Hawaii. Second, even if he was born in Hawaii, like he says he was, Barack Obama's father was Kenyan. So he was a dual citizen at birth, citizen of the Commonwealth of Great Britain. Kenya was a Commonwealth country, and a U.S. citizen. A dual citizen is not a natural-born citizen. And third, I think Obama used a different name, this Lolo Sutoro, or Soibarka, Barack Obama Soibarka, in Indonesia. His mother removed him from his passport. I think Barack Obama was a dual citizen again in Indonesia. And if that's the case, that's an independent reason Barack Obama is not eligible to be president. So these are the major issues. I don't even think it's a close argument. I think it's abundantly clear Barack Obama was and is not eligible to be president. He should never have been allowed to run for the office.
So Dr. Corsi, so irrespective of where he's born, he's not qualified because of his dual citizenship.
Correct.
Now, would you just briefly get into the, as we know, that the 14th Amendment is used, unfortunately, I would say perverted, to give the impression that it has to do with the presidency and the office and the natural-born citizen clause. Could you just get into that a little bit?
Yeah.
About how that has been used to really skew this argument in a direction that it should have never been in, meaning precisely, that it's become, unfortunately, commonly misunderstood that to be a natural-born citizen simply means that you're born on U.S. soil, regardless of any other factors. Can you just explain that briefly?
Well, we need to separate native birth and natural-born citizen. The 14th Amendment specifically does not redefine Article 2, Section 1 of the Constitution. There's no reference back to Article 2, Section 1. Now, a person has been interpreted, I think, incorrectly under the 14th Amendment to be if you were born in the United States on U.S. soil, you are a U.S. citizen. The 14th Amendment says, born here and subject to the jurisdiction thereof. And arguably, I think two, for instance, immigrant parents, certainly two diplomats, whose loyalty is to a different country, being the parent, would not convey citizenship on the child. But that's how we have interpreted the 14th Amendment. So a person could be under the 14th Amendment a citizen and native-born, but not natural-born. And the criteria for natural-born, I think, was again affirmed when John McCain submitted his birth credentials to Congress in 2008, something that Obama refused to do. And the resolution, Senate Resolution 511 for John McCain, a resolution that was co-sponsored by Barack Obama, specified that McCain was a natural-born citizen because, first of all, he had two U.S. citizen parents when he was born. They were both citizens. And secondly, he was not born in the United States. He was born, John McCain, in the Canal Zone. But, again, I think the Senate correctly distinguished that the Founding Fathers never meant somebody to be disqualified from running for president because they were born on foreign soil with their parents serving in the defense of the nation and the military. And
right.
That was the case. John McCain's father was on the naval base in the Panama Canal Zone. His mother was visiting, and the baby was born. But it's distinct. It's completely different for Barack Obama, who does not have two U.S. citizen parents. I think the definition of natural-born citizen, going back really to the only Supreme Court case on point, which was a 1874 case, Minor versus Happersett, is two U.S. citizen parents when you're born and born on U.S. soil. That's what a natural-born citizen is, not a 14th Amendment citizen.
Right. It's just interesting with how this 14th Amendment, I've had direct conversations with attorneys who are on, let's say, the other side on this issue. And when you read the plain text of the 14th Amendment, which I'm going to do just very quickly, all persons born or naturalized in the United States and subject to the jurisdiction thereof are citizens of the United States, and then it continues. But one point that's interesting that seems to be overlooked is that the persons born are one class, and then the other class is naturalized, and they're both considered citizens for the purpose of the 14th Amendment. So the logical understanding should then be that naturalized citizens would be in the same class as born citizens, born on native-born, as you said. And then it's all conflated to be the same as naturalized. So it's not even a distinction between naturalized here.
Well, and see, look, it's key to realize that Article 2, Section 1 is not about whether somebody's a citizen. It's a subset of citizen. It's a natural-born citizen. And what the Founding Fathers wanted was someone who to be president who had no divided loyalty, no divided citizenship loyalty to the United States. That's the key point. So if you're a dual citizen, especially a Great Britain, which Barack Obama was at birth, well, that'd be the last person the Founding Fathers wanted in the presidency, because we just fought a Revolutionary War against Great Britain, and the Founding Fathers did not want a back door into U.S. citizenship for a citizen of Great Britain to assert that they were a citizen and hence able to be president. That's why they defined it more narrowly to be not just a citizen, but a natural-born citizen.
So
that's
some very real
for people to follow, but it's really pretty simple.
So in some very real sense, Barack Obama is almost a textbook example of who they wanted to make sure didn't get to that office in terms of his dual citizenship and the potential for divided loyalty, and more specifically with Great Britain by virtue of the fact that Kenya was a protectorate of Great Britain when he was born.
He's the exact person that the Founding Fathers did not want. And that's the key point. And it's amazing to me that, you know, we continue to go through all of the debate over whether Barack Obama was born in Hawaii or born in Kenya, and don't realize that for a completely separate reason, the fact that he was a dual citizen at birth, or a dual citizen again in Indonesia when he was using a different name, Barry Sitoro, and I assume that name had legal significance, he was using it. His mother put down his passport, he was, you know, Barack Hussein Obama Soy Barka, Mm-hmm. Again, seems to be a legal designation of a name, even if he didn't formally go in and get that name changed. Both states acknowledge that using a name is enough to make it a legal name.
What's interesting regarding the name, just a quick footnote, is virtually close to 3 years ago, I remember seeing a document listing, it was Barack Obama's application to the Illinois Bar, and very specifically, the question was, other names used, and in capital letters it said none, and the name that he listed was Barack Hussein Obama, with no other aliases, AKAs, nothing else was listed.
You mean he didn't include Sotero?
Sotero, no. He didn't include anything other than the name he put on the application.
What? And that should have, right then again, you know, been a reason for being disbarred, because, you know, that's perjury. You're saying under oath that you never used another name. And in fact, Barry Sotero was a legally used additional name for Barack Obama. And, you know,
Dr. Corsi, let me ask you. I understand that both Barack Obama and his wife have voluntarily surrendered their law licenses.
Yes, that's correct. Now, I called and talked to the Bar Association in Illinois, and they say that they cannot use the fact that they withdrew their licenses as proof that there was a disciplinary action or some other reason why they lost their licenses. It's widely suspected that Barack Obama, because he did not acknowledge that he had this second name, this alias, that it was a legal name, Barry Sotero, and for Michelle, she accepted something like $300,000 for, I believe, the University of Chicago Hospital when she was working there while Barack Obama was in the Illinois Senate, and funded that money through Michelle to the university. You can't prove that that's the reason they don't have their law licenses or they voluntarily surrendered them.
Right. So in a sense,
it can't prove it.
It's a rebuttable presumption at this point. And
Yeah,
but it's just one more thing, isn't it?
There's one more evidence that we can't see. In other words, if, in fact, they just voluntarily submitted their licenses, why doesn't Barack Obama unseal those records and let a full inspection occur of the reasons why he did not renew his law license in Illinois?
Well,
more hiding of information.
Right. Well, as an attorney licensed in the state of New Jersey, it's stunning to relinquish a law license that you work so hard to get, and unless it's for cause, you don't do something like that. Unless for some reason you're retiring, you're moving to another state, whatever the case may be.
Well, example is Bill Clinton. Bill Clinton surrendered his law license, and the belief was that was anticipation of it being taken away from him because of his perjury.
Well, and look, of course, Bill Clinton, was impeached and did commit perjury. He lied under oath. And what you find is that most lawyers, and you know, would not surrender a license voluntarily if all that was involved was a renewal fee of a couple hundred dollars. It's not like he was saving a lot of money by not keeping his law license.
Right, you just don't do that.
You don't do that. Once you've gotten a license, I mean, I've had securities licenses, NASD licenses, for over 20 years. I'm not about to surrender them. I'm going to do everything I can to keep them current because I don't want to take the test again or have to get reinstated if I want to actively use those licenses on a full-time capacity. So I remain active and I remain current with the licenses. Barack Obama and Michelle both surrendered their licenses, which is suspect. And it should be explained and the documents should be available. If Barack Obama was truly going to be transparent, that'd be another of the class of documents we'd be allowed to see.
And speaking of all the documents that we're not allowed to see, in your book, toward the end, in one of the appendixes, you list all of the documents that he hasn't surrendered. And the list just goes on and on.
It's a startling list, isn't it?
Yes.
I mean, we don't even have the kindergarten record. The records are relevant. I mean, the school records are relevant in a number of ways. Was he ever listed as a foreign student? When he listed his place of birth, did he ever put down Kenya or Mombasa in Kenya? Did he get foreign student aid? These are issues that, again, we won't know and we'll never be able to know until you, who recommended him for these colleges and universities. Barack Obama says he self-admits and dreams to my father that he was very actively smoking marijuana and using cocaine in his first 2 years when he was in Occidental. Well, and he also says his grades were terrible. Well, how does he suddenly end up going to Columbia, which is a prestige university that usually requires very good grades to get in? Who recommended him? How did he pay for it?
Again, well, yeah.
We don't even know all the countries Barack Obama traveled to. And so when, you know, various people speculate, well, he went to Russia and got training in Russia. Well, we can't rule it out because Barack Obama won't tell you all the countries he's been to.
So it's interesting the way this whole debate has gotten flipped around on its head for almost 3 years, that it's
right.
That the burden of production, the burden of persuasion, the burden of proof has been flipped on its head, that it's essentially on the people of the United States to show that he is not who he said he was, as opposed to for him to just produce documentation to support who he in fact is.
And
I mean, it's just absolutely amazing to try to...
Even more, you know, if we... who ask these questions are cast as fringe or racist, when the same identical questions were asked by the Democrats of McCain.
Yes.
Well, the Democrats want to be able to pursue the natural-born question when it disqualifies Republicans. As a radical group of Saul Alinsky activists that have taken over the Democratic Party want to ridicule anybody who raises identical questions about their candidates for the presidency.
Right. We've done a couple of shows and have gotten into pretty heavily Senate Resolution 511, which we're referencing now regarding John McCain.
Right.
And one aspect of your book that I think is really it's fabulous is the fact that you have all these exhibits in here, because I mean I've seen many of these exhibits at one point time or another, but to have them all in one place where you could reference them and access them is really, it's a great resource. What's interesting is with all the articles that were written in the spring of 2008 regarding John McCain and his eligibility issues because of the fact that he was not born in the mainland of the United States.
Yeah, I've almost got 10 pages of exhibit.
Yeah,
and
it's yeah.
Most people remember that McCain was questioned, but few people remember all the articles published. How, you know, here you've got the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, you've got the London Sunday Times, CBS, MSNBC, blogs like the PolitiFact, Daily Cause, these groups that are supposed to be, you know, independent blogs like PolitiFact, the UPI, Snopes, you know, Snopes is supposed to be fact-checking, all of them writing McCain doesn't qualify as a natural-born citizen and raising the issue of whether he's eligible to be president. Completely.
And some of the articles raise the issue in a very substantive way, legally.
Right. Well, see, again, the key issue for McCain was that McCain was born in the Panama Canal Zone. And I think there's excellent evidence that the founders never meant, you know, these other operatives who have been, I think, breaking laws, just like Donald Segretti in Watergate.
Yes.
You know, these leftists and the Democratic Party radicals think that they can, play dirty tricks on campaigns and have it be considered satire or a joke. Well, you know, it's not necessarily a joke if you're intervening in a criminal case with malice to disrupt the case with false information.
So you think that if they proceed, if a lot of these legal cases and efforts proceed in a variety of areas, hopefully they'll chip away at the people surrounding him.
Even in an ancillary capacity.
Sure.
Because
so
let's say
they're looking for a John Dean.
Exactly. And I think you've already got a John Dean. I think when when Robert Baer, who was White House counsel, Perkins Coie, quit.
Right.
I think he realized, and I think you've got now a lot of people in the White House who realized, I went through this with John Kerry. We did a Swiftbull campaign. And I remember
I have a question when we have a break
about this and saying, look, Terry has been saying for years that he was a Vietnam War hero, and all his
right.
supporters believed him. So we come out with Unfit for Command, and they come to John Kerry, and they say, what are the answers to all these? You surely must be able to tell us, John Kerry, because the SWPO veterans have to be lying since they're saying you're not a hero, and you've told us you were a hero. And suddenly, Kerry doesn't have very convincing answers. Well, in the White House, you've got to believe there's a lot of people in the White House who've taken the same forensic look at that long-form birth certificate released on the White House website, and I said, what is this? And who realize, because they're lawyers themselves, that the best evidence is the document that's still locked away in Hawaii, and if this had been a genuine effort, you'd have released that. So the support within the White House begins to crumble by people who suddenly realize you're lying. Now, if we chip away at these side cases, one or more of them could reach the heart and to the White House through a judge saying, I'm not going to let you go at the president himself, but if you're going to go against Bill Bryant, and Bill Bryant wants to defend himself, now we've got a reason for discovery at the White House, and that gets you right where you wanted to be.
So let's carry the analogy a little further. As you know, the mainstream media is useless. In this event,
Am I still on the air?
Yeah.
I have a question for Dr. Corsi on these OBOTs, if I can get one in.
Yes, go ahead.
The Dr. Conspiracy site, the gentleman who runs that has been named as Kevin Davidson out of, I believe, Greer, South Carolina, or someplace
I've seen it on the internet.
He allegedly worked for the Vital Statistics Department of that state and had access to all the knowledge about birth certificates. And I wonder, just possibly speculating, if he has anything to do with these falsified, red herring, phony birth certificates that have been put out, you know, to kind of like muck up the water, misinformation, and whether or not you could take a look at the Dr. Conspiracy site and some of the misinformation he's putting out down there, too.
I would like to. In fact, I've done a pretty thorough analysis of the birth certificates that the White House released, and I found in several graphic artists characteristics of their work.
But isn't it interesting that he works in the Vital Statistics Department for a state, and he would know all about birth certificates and forging forgeries?
Well, Commander, if you can get me that information, that'd be very good. I showed already in the one article I published how this Bromford document, the one that was created from the Australian birth certificate, was a foggy job. He didn't do the forgery, but he distributed the forgery, and he claims to have distributed the forgery. So, you know, it's clear that these, what they call OBOTs, these radical Obama supporters, have already engaged in birth certificate fraud. Now, again, they want to claim that that's satire, and I'm not a criminal attorney.
It's just like the Esquire article, right?
Right, but at some point or other, there is a legal action here that a judge will allow to be brought.
Right.
Well, I know all this information is, I've read emails and things that is being forwarded to Ellie Tate, too, so I'm sure she's been particularly viciously attacked by these people.
Yes. And in fact, it's clear that they set out to attack Orly Tate, and to even in her current motions to see if they can't, if this guy Foggy is, you know, the has got motions filed with the current judges to see if he can't get more penalties imposed upon Orly Tate.
Right, to silence her.
These people that are lawyers there, from what I can understand, have high level connections back to the White House through. DNC law firms and big name Washington law firms. These people are not just operating independently. I believe I believe this is part of an orchestrated misinformation campaign, akin almost to what you saw in the Cold War between the Russians, KGB and the
CIA.
Commander,
not to cut you off, but we only have about 5 minutes left.
All right, I'll hang up and listen.
Really
bye bye. Keep up the good work.
You'll remember that when the Watergate investigation occurred, one of the key breaks in the Watergate information was Donald Segretti.
Yes.
And it was the proof that, in fact, the White House and the, in particular the Democratic National Committee, the Committee to Re-elect the President at that time, 1972, had engaged in dirty tricks against candidates of the Democratic Party like Ed Muskie.
Yes.
Writing false letters and putting misinformation into the campaign. And Segretti went to the prison for those activities.
Yes. And he folded.
And he folded, and it was another way through which the case broke. In other words, what the commander was asking earlier is how do we break this case when you've got the mainstream media that doesn't want to cover it, got John Boehner that doesn't want to cover it, and I'm suggesting that, you know, it's not necessarily a frontal attack that's going to work, but there's a lot of other things going on out there, including these OBOTs, which we now have evidence on, which is, again, a way to bring legal actions against these people and to break the case wide open to the American public.
So, Dr. Corsi, you referenced John Boehner and some of the others, and even, I mean, who in many ways I think is on the right track with a lot of things, but for some reason she's totally off for this on this issue for the whole time it's been a problem, Michelle Bachmann and some of the others. What's going on with these Republicans in particular that nobody wants to go near this guy, and it's just absolutely stunning that the Republicans got strong control of the House now, and they're doing seemingly nothing except backpedaling, and they're afraid to open their mouths. I mean, what do you think is happening here? Because that's really one of the most discouraging aspects about this whole thing in terms of the political system.
But look, it's really, again, let's think about this carefully. A very effective disinformation tool is to accuse somebody of being a racist, especially in our society, which is, you know, moved in the sense of being liberal Democrats on ideas of race, ever since the Warren Court. And so nobody wants to be accused of this, and it will back off. We've got a generation now in positions of power in the media, even on Wall Street, that were trained by leftist professors and leftist universities since the end of the Vietnam War. And this whole idea of being afraid to raise an issue because you don't want to appear to have crossed that line and been a racist attacking Obama, this is something that's going to require some courage on the part of these politicians, which they don't have.
For 3 years, and at this point, over 240
Republicans? The point I want to make is this, that the American voters need to understand fully that the Republican Party is not a conservative party. You know, it is not. It's a centrist party, and it has a tendency sometimes to be centrist left. I pointed this out even against George W. Bush. I wrote the late, great USA and talked about open borders and the Security and Prosperity Partnership and the merger with Mexico and Canada. People get fooled to think that the Republican Party is going to be a conservative party, is going to hold the constitutional principles. And both of our parties move to the center, especially in electing president. The issue, however, politically is going to be, I think the move's already started within the Democratic Party to ditch Obama. I think the Democrats would much rather run with Hillary Clinton. And it's possible that the Republicans would rather run against Obama than Hillary Clinton.
Oh,
they're calculating their political advantage rather than, you know, conservative principles or preserving the Constitution, because it's a political party and it's designed, the Republican Party, just like the Democratic Party, to get people elected to hold office. It's not an ideologically driven party.
That's stunning to think that. And it's not, I mean, it's reasonable. That's why it's stunning to think that the Republicans are going to back off Obama, or have been backing off Obama, will continue to back off Obama, because they want him to get the nomination, because they think he's an easier
I think that's
opponent.
The calculation.
That's just disgusting.
They don't want to face Hillary. And the backdrop of this story is, and in recent days you even started seeing Obama suggesting he doesn't need to be a two-term president. Well, Obama knows what's coming. The issues we've been discussing in this program are only going to gain momentum, even if they gain momentum below the surface. At any given day, a case is going to break open. At any given day, somebody in the White House is going to come forward and say, we all knew he was lying all the time. At any given day, I'm going to get a document out of Kenya which makes it indisputable Obama was born there. I mean, these are the kinds of risks that Obama takes, having lied about who he is.
Do you see a point coming at which the mainstream media is going to actually inform the American people about what even resembles the truth here?
Yeah,
I mean, they've backed themselves into a corner.
It may happen through the London press. You know, I've been in discussions, the London Times may break the story, or it may be Der Spiegel, or one of the Europeans that really catches on to this and breaks it open. Obama's running a great risk right now, and the great risk is he's lied. The reason they tried to prevent my book being published, where's the birth certificate, is that they couldn't afford for this book to become a bestseller, and it did become a bestseller. With virtually no television, I've done something like 120 radio shows. We organized that strategy with no media coverage in the printed press, really, except negative. But the point is, the American people out there, there are millions of Americans for whom this is a big issue and who've seen the evidence themselves. And, you know, you gentlemen have done a great job, Commander Kirshner, Orly Tate, the list goes on. Not me alone, a whole group of Americans who believe in the Constitution are willing to fight for it. Have convinced millions of American people that Barack Obama is running a cover-up. He won't tell anybody who he is. I started it when I wrote The Abomination. I said, this is a radical leftist guy.
Well, I don't mean to cut you off, Dr. Corsi. Our time is just about up. Thank you so much for being with us. If you'd like to do it again, you have an open invitation. And I'd just like to say that, just to our audience, we don't stop this usurper and his band of traitors. And they continue to get away with this. And they're not exposed and brought to justice. We're going to lose the Constitution, we're going to lose the rule of law, and we're going to end up losing the Republic. This isn't a joke, and people have to wake up and understand this is deadly serious, and the stakes couldn't be higher. And thank you again, Dr. Corsi, and that's Billy and Dan out for now. See you next week. Thank you.
Thank you, Doctor.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.